left.
Victoria's back.
And our heroes give chase.
Between the Cullens chasing for her and the wolves, because she's going back from Cullen territory to wolf territory.
It's really intense, because we all want to kill each other.
I mean, it is the perfect way to start the movie off.
In the book, Bella only hears about the ravine confrontation after the fact. What I was able to do is to take that off-screen encounter from the book and we actually get to see it.
It's something which is quite small in the book that I felt, you know, I'd really like to see. That'd be like a really fun thing to see.
David then took that and just went full bore with it.
Really get the arms going.
A.J. Forrester was my second unit director, and he was wonderful. He was completely and utterly on the same plane.
His mandate for the sequence was fast, fast, fast. This is a car chase.
One of the biggest challenges of the movie has always been to capture vampire speed, as Stephanie described it in her books.
David came up with this idea, call it the magic carpet.
It's like a 4-foot-wide piece that we towed on a computerized winch that just haul people along.
And you've got your actors literally running at full speed, but everything's whizzing by, all the trees in the background.
So it's kind of like that thing when you're at an airport and someone's on the walkway alongside of you and they're walking, but they're going faster than you. It's that same thing. So long as you're not seeing their feet, it feels like they're actually going very fast. But in fact, they're going as fast as humans can, plus the 30 or 40 clicks that the pickup truck is adding to what they're doing. The magic carpet looks really great, but it can only do certain things. So then you have to find other ways of making that same look happen.
Once you start putting it all together, some of it works as planned, some of it doesn't. So that's when the rest of our team kind of kicks into action.
Victoria leaps and bounds through, sort of like a deer or an antelope would through an environment, which is, you know, the human equivalent of that is sort of parkour. So we've got these great gymnasts who, either with a little bit of help from trampolines and air rams and things, are able to do some pretty amazing stuff.
There were some things that the stunt actors just couldn't do, so we also have computer-generated digital double characters in that scene, and we have the performances of these computer-generated werewolves running through it at the same time.
The ravine was just hard to figure out what we were doing. The guys from Image Engine came up with a very simple way of scanning environments, so they would go back to these places in the woods and sort of do a video scan of the location and then bring it into previs and run around on it.
For sequences that involve visual effects, you want to hand it off to a previs artist, because what you're trying to do is sort of look at the shots you're going to need that will have a wolf in them later and make sure that that's what you shoot on the day when you don't have the wolf there.
We use pre-visualization to literally conceive how to shoot the plates in general and how to shoot the elements resulting from those plates.
Then do a post-vis process on those plates and animate CG characters in the scenes, and that would give us the data that we needed to know to then go to the green screen stage.
So then when we're on set filming the green screen footage, they actually had a mini little cut already sliced together, and they could use that to try and block out their green screen angles to see how their character was going to move through the scene, and that's how we went about shooting all that footage.
And then those elements are again taken back into CG and projected into what we're calling a digital magic carpet, where we're actually animating the elements in 3D space that then end up getting composited into the show.
By using pre-visualization, it allows you to know exactly what you're going into a remote location to shoot, and you literally just don't have time to waste. So it's all about efficiencies, really.
Action!
The watchword on this was to try to be superhuman, not supernatural, in order to try to keep it interesting to look at.
Just wanted to try and do something fresh and different on this that would, at the same time, you would accept.
The ravine chase is something that in its totality is really something that we're pretty proud of.
We really touched on almost every technique used in computer graphics to effectively execute on that sequence.
So for the first time in the movies, we're really seeing vampires run through the woods at a speed that is impossible to sort of accomplish with real performers. It's gonna, I think, be a pretty fantastic sequence.
On every show, we try and take advantage of the next leap in technology and sophistication. Usually the first model is basically our beta testing thing, so we're working out all of the issues, mostly in terms of look and dynamics. The trick, of course, was take the version of what we had on New Moon and turn it into the next version on. I'm Phil Tippett, and I'm a visual effects supervisor and wolf wrangler. You know, when you're doing creatures that people are very familiar with, like cats and dogs, you know, wolves certainly fall into the canine category. So a tremendous amount of effort is put into, you know, studying canine behavior. Wolves act and behave differently than dogs.
So my job was to basically rely a lot upon reference. What we had shot when we went down to Wolf Mountain and sat with the wolves for an entire day in their pens.
The director really wanted to get the wolves as looking as absolutely realistic as possible. And that was fine by us and fine by the animators. We're really excited by that. We wanted an opportunity to really get to the nitty-gritty of the wolves
and find out how that might relate to the characters that we're portraying in the film.
And ultimately, what we ended up doing was what David called a leaner and meaner wolf.
We changed the proportions slightly.
Giving him a tummy tuck and basically beefing up musculature. And then we shortened the fur a little bit just so that you could start to read that musculature. Then David said, well, what about more and finer fur? We already had millions of hairs on our creatures. So we were like, well, we're not sure we can do that, but we can try.
We pushed a lot of our technology further than we've ever pushed it on Eclipse. That's the work of our brilliant technical art director, Aaron.
There's like a groom program that runs on the outside of the wolf and it grows all the hairs all over the wolf. So it was like an on-the-fly filling in of fur. I think even King Kong only had 4 or 5 million hairs on it. And we were able to get almost 20.
The new wolves are Seth and Leia and Quill.
Quill is sort of just another member of the pack. He's very similar to the other guys that we've already seen in the last movie.
Seth is a much smaller, younger wolf than everybody else.
So his wolf has a different set of markings. You know, he's a lighter tan-colored wolf.
Leia is our female wolf, so we wanted to make like a cool, sexy wolf that had a non-guy presence.
You know, and you do that through posing and a little bit of groom, you know, and just a little bit of shaping of the muzzle.
Leia is a light gray wolf, and so we pulled some of the coloration from Seth into Leia to create that relationship between them.
I read this script, and I was like, wow, we're at war. This is gonna be the best. I'm gonna be like, you know, Jet Li in this. Oh, wait. Whenever I do anything cool or anything action-oriented, I am a wolf.
This movie has its own very unique challenges because of sheer scale. What they had to do with wolves on the last movie doesn't, it pales by comparison. The level of interaction is two orders of magnitude greater. Basically, you had to get an eye line. And now they have to actually jump on each other, bite, roll over, and, you know, somebody dies. It's much more difficult to figure out how to do that.
Primarily, my bread and butter is in the setup and the layout and making sure that we've got what we need on the set. Because in addition to just getting the shots, there's a tremendous amount of technical type work that needs to be done in order to place the wolves back into the shots.
We are looking at one of our four wolf standees. These guys basically tell us how large the wolves are, get the camera framed up, get the actors on the eye line, stuff like that.
Give me an open shot. And you took it. See that?
The sticks of fur, or fur loaves, as we like to call them, are basically four different colors of fur. They represent the four different kinds of shades of the actual wolves. And we hold them up under the lights so we can kind of get a reference for what they're supposed to look like. So when we do it digitally, we can match as close as possible.
My job is basically to survey the set, and I'll strategically shoot points on this hill right here to define what that hill is, and I'll use those points so that we can build a 3D model of it later, so that our wolves have something to stand on, and the animators know where in space things sat.
Hey, Jake.
There was a great deal more personal interaction between our wolf characters and the humans in this case. There's an intimate moment where Jacob joins Bella, so in that particular instance, Taylor was dressed up in a kind of a non-reflective gray outfit and actually acted the scene with Kristen to get the right kind of eye lines and motivation and all of that kind of thing. So that was very carefully laid out.
The way the sequence was originally designed, Jacob just comes up to Bella and they sort of, you know, just are right next to each other and they're talking and it's very cute and beautiful. And David said, in this shot, I want you to sort of put your head down and Kristen, you just sort of rub his head.
That was not exactly what we had expected. How are we gonna actually get her hand moving around his fur?
We know that's gonna be a technical challenge.
Of course, what we have to do ultimately is cover Taylor up with a wolf, and where you see him, we have to paint him out and restore the background.
So once this gets transposed into a wolf land, it's basically a hairless wolf. Physically, her hand is actually scratching him on the forehead in this shot. And then once we send it through comp, that'll be fully realized.
There's no hiding anything on a shot like that. It's just, it's all up on the screen. So you really want your attention to be on the performance of the characters.
And you have to feel a real connection.
You know, she leans into him and he pushes her back.
And to make sure that dynamic feels palpably performance worthy.
The thing that's gratifying for us is we have heard repeatedly that all the girls go, "Aw," because they feel this connection between Jacob and Bella. I'm very happy about that for our animation team. I feel like we've been successful in that way.
It's always gratifying to get the audience's response and realize that, you know, hey, it all came together and it worked.
People look at the digital wolves not as a computer effect, but as Jacob, you know, and all of the fans of the movie are looking at these scenes and like, oh yeah, that's just how I thought he would do it. So for us, being able to focus on characters is really satisfying.
Our kind is never more physically powerful than in our first several months of this life.
Now, the two most important things to remember are, first, never let them get their arms around you. They'll crush you instantly. And second, never go for the obvious kill.
Here we go.
They'll be expecting that.
Roll camera. 3, 2, 1, go.
Again!
Cut!
Well, here at Camp Howdy, is where Jasper trains the Cullen family. And so right over there in that kind of circle area, that's where we do our training session.
We're shooting a fight!
Here we go. Ready? Shoulder up, boys.
Basically what it is, kind of teaching vampire-to-vampire combat. We're trying to stay away from a lot of the martial arts elements to not make it look like a kung fu movie.
Don't hold back.
Not in my nature.
We worked a lot on actual vampire combat. Because there's so much of it, we had to get a real systematic way how we all fought.
You block different and you hold your stances different. We're vampires, so we don't have to hold our boxing stance.
I'm awake now, I think.
You just want to make the styles fit the personality of who's doing it. Damn it. He's a big guy, so you want to make him more like strength-based.
He's invincible. He just bulldozes through everything. Rosalie's dirty.
Come on, Rosalie! Come on, Rosalie!
It's like if she was a human in a bar fight. She'll break a glass bottle and use it. Oh. Yeah, that's...